Where am I gonna go on holiday? Wales.
Hi guys, welcome back to scalemotor. So where are we at now? We're at part three, the third and final part of the Meng GT-40. As I mentioned in the last video, it's done. It's over there. You would have seen pictures already at the beginning, and if you follow me on Instagram or any other social media, you would have seen it there. But yeah, I'm a little behind on the videos, as you've probably guessed. But yeah, this video we're gonna be finishing everything up. We're gonna be doing the interior. There's a couple of bits and bobs which I liked about the interior, and maybe one or two bits which I don't want to say I didn't like. Just seemed a bit strange to me. But yeah, mainly the interior. We're gonna be getting the body on and everything, and we're doing our final glamour shots. I don't have any videos of the final glamour shot. Maybe I should start recording that. No. Anyway, yeah, so with this marks the end of another build. First Le Mans car. First Le Mans car. I did enjoy it. Yeah. So yeah, anyway, I'm gonna stop rambling on, and we're just gonna jump in and I'll have a little chat about it at the end. So back again with some more priming using Mr. Finishing Surface Finisher Boy Fella Black 1500. This is quite a good primer. I really like it. I thinned it with Mr. Leveling Thinner, and I'm spraying it actually with a 0.2 needle, just because that's what was in the airbrush at the time. And we've done three coats. The coverage is absolutely excellent, so it does look like I'm putting down a lot more than I actually am. But yeah, three coats, and you'll find that it covers whatever you need really, really well. Just making sure we get in those little nooks and crannies, those crevices, just the little areas where we, you know, where we really don't want to miss any paint. I primed pretty much the whole thing in this, all that we were using for the interior, and then we went on to the GX2 gloss black by Mr. Hobby. This is my favourite gloss black. It goes down really, really well. Again, this is thinned with Mr. Leveling Thinner. Both this and the primer would be thinned about 70%. I think I started about 50% and then worked my way up with the thinner. But yeah, we're doing the gloss black now on the parts which are gonna have a metallic finish. These little things are the shiny bits which go inside behind the light lenses. So kind of the whole kind of light bay area is painted with a Mr. Finishing Surfacer Boy, because it leaves a nice finish, and then that shiny bit goes on, so you don't have to bother painting the whole kind of back area of the light. And then the seats are leather, so they will be painted with the gloss black too. Okay, so moving on, this is the primer done. Now you can see is the Mr. Finishing Surfacer done on the inside of the light, like we mentioned, and the ducts, I suppose, on the bottom left and the bottom right of the front. I didn't catch myself masking these up because I'm a pleb, but yeah, I'm gonna just quickly go through unmasking them because they came out pretty well. There's two little ducts, and then the very bottom left and very bottom right is more lights. Yeah, I was quite chuffed with that. managed to not get any overspray on the body, so that's great. And then we moved on to a little bit more masking, and there's a couple of bits on the dashboard which need to be painted a metal colour. I think on the real car they're like brushed metal, I'm not too sure, but yeah, we're just going to mask them up. And the easiest way I found to do this is just put some masking tape down on the bench, cut it into little slivers, and then using the tip of a cocktail stick to just poke it down into place. Now that there's, I think there's three separate little areas, but there are lines and seams for you to follow, so it really wasn't too strenuous of a masking task, this. You shouldn't really have any issues. If you do find you're having a couple of little issues, just try first using thinner masking tape just to get right up to the line, and then you don't have to be as accurate then with the next layer of masking tape. You can go a little thicker and build it up until you're covering most of the other areas. So with that done, we also moved on to masking the very, very centre of the steering wheel. This could have been done with a circle cutter or a circle template or whatever, but I had the masking tape out and I thought I'd just piece it until I got a nice circle around the middle. It could be quite daunting masking tiny circles, but if you're slow about it and meticulous, you shouldn't really have much of a problem. And then we're just going to use thicker masking tape just to make sure we don't end up painting the actual steering wheel. Okay, now we're going to be using the alcad aluminium. Again, using a 0.2 needle, we've turned down the pressure on the airbrush. Again, I'm not certain the exact pressure because of the terrible compressor that I'm using. And we've also tightened the trigger tension on our airbrush, and we're just going to slowly build up the coats. The thing is with the alcad is when I'm using the aluminium, I don't tend to go as slow, just because with the aluminium I'm just looking for a kind of metal colour finish, not an exactly metal finish, if you know what I mean, not shiny or anything. And it was at this point I realised that there was another piece which I had totally forgot to mask, which also needed to be aluminium. And that was, there's a section on the front and back of this, which I'm masking off now, which, this goes on the inside of the rear shell. And you can see that through the rear window, and that part needed to be painted an aluminium colour. And I don't know why, but it just came to me as I was painting there. So yeah, we got that masked off as good as we could, and then we went back over to our filthy spray booth. Okay, yeah, and then we carried on with the alcad aluminium. This, I haven't got a gloss black base for the majority of the parts I'm painting with this, because I don't need a deep kind of shine to it. It is just a kind of metal colour I'm going for. Okay, and there I am back at the bench, surrounded by masking tape. But now we come into unmask. This is my absolute favourite part. And I was eager to see if my very, very quick last minute masking actually worked. And it did. We got no bleed through. And we just painted the areas we needed to. The good thing is, as I was using alcad, I was kind of spraying a little slower than I would usually. Just because it's alcad. So yeah, it didn't go on wet enough to get any kind of bleed through or anything like that. So I think I was lucky, because it was a quick masking job. But yeah, we got there and it turned out quite well. And speaking of masking, this is one of my least favourite parts, window masks. So these window masks that came in the kit are unbelievably sticky. Honestly, I don't know why they're so sticky, but yeah, they are super, super sticky, and they did leave some residue on the windows afterwards. So I decided to try putting the masks on this way. So I cut them as close as I could to that blue line, which is the shape of the actual window. And there's a cut on them inside because they are pre-cut. And then I took the little border off around the outside there. And then I kind of thought, well, I treat it like a plaster, I suppose. So I cut, I peeled halfway, placed it face up, and then I used the sharp hobby knife to just cut half of the backing off. That way I can still keep hold of the mask, because it still has backing on one half, so I can still keep hold of it and maneuver it and get it into place, because you can slide the backing along the window, and then when you're kind of where you think you need to be, you can push down the sticky side. As you can see now, it is rather easy to line up. And then we just give it a little, just tweak it, get it to where it needs to go, and then see, you can see it is very, very sticky. See that? We eventually got there. And then what you can do, one side down, fold it over, push, and it'll stick, and it'll be all in line. Excellent. We've done the same then for the rear window. The lenses, they were pretty simple. There's some kind of lines on the lenses and stuff anyway. And the side windows, again, super simple. So I didn't need to kind of do that fold in half malarkey like I done on the front and the back. And then we moved over to the booth to spray the black around the outside. And this, again, is the Mr. Surfacer 1500. And you're just going to slowly build it up, because we're using lacquer thinner and lacquer paint on clear parts. You do want to go quite slow, because you don't want to end up crazing or anything, and you don't want to end up bleeding under. Like, you can use Mr. Levelin thinner to remove any overspray or any bleed through, but I generally try and avoid cleaning clear parts with lacquer thinner, just in case. Yeah, just slowly go around the outsides, building it up, and I'm kind of spraying from the centre outwards, if you know what I mean. So away from the edge of the masking tape. So if there is any kind of gappage or any areas where the paint can seep through, we're trying to avoid that. Okay, and while they were drying, we moved on to the seats. Now, these seats are insane. There are hundreds, I don't know if there's hundreds, but there are loads of little silver kind of, I don't know what they are. They're like buttons or something anyway, and it's part of the seat, and they're all silver, so we decided to use a pen instead of painting, and it didn't go too bad. It did take a little while, but the actual centres, which are painted silver, are raised, and the outside there's a recess, so you want to be careful and just make sure you dab in that raised bit, because otherwise the silver can bleed and it can look a bit pants. It is quite hard. I wouldn't say hard, it's just very repetitive. So it's easy to get sloppy when you're doing the same thing over and over and over and over again. So just take your time, be patient. It is worth it, because the finish, you know, it, the little things set it off. It'd be cool if these were molded in such a way where maybe the seat has just got loads of holes in, and there's a backing piece which you pop through and the backing piece is just all the buttons which come through the holes maybe, so you could paint it separately, just make it a little easier, or if there was some sort of mask, but because of the kind of the shape and the contours on the seat, I don't think it would work very well. But once we'd done that, we moved on to something else small and fiddly, the decals. Not many on the inside, most of these are dials and gauges, but we've got our multi-use ramekin back there, which gets washed out and used for various different things, and that's full of warm water. And the thing I did notice with these decals is if you put them in the warm water after about 5 seconds, you can pull them out and they're sliding around the backing paper, which is pretty good. So what we're doing first is we're putting a bit of microset down. We're popping the decal in the water, bringing it out, popping the decal on top of the microset, giving it a little poke with a cotton bud, just to kind of remove any excess. Give it a couple of minutes and then we're going to hit it with a UMP set in solution. And I went straight for the strong because I know from the body that these could handle the strong, and it worked quite well. I was just giving them a little poke around to try and make sure they were all the right orientation and none of them were pointing the wrong way or anything, even though they can barely be seen through the window. I'd know, that would annoy me. And there we go, after we've had the setting solution on for a little while, we're just going to give them a poke to make sure they have conformed and we pull out any of the excess moisture. Now, these decals were not fun at all. I don't know why I hated them so much, but I did not enjoy doing these decals. So I've cut as close to the decal as possible, and then we're just going to slide them off onto the wheel after they've been in the water. We've put a bit of the microset down again, and then I'm going to use my tweezers just to try and get them in place. But they were quite brittle and they did break, and it did seem that maybe in some places they were slightly too short. I'm not too sure. However, it wasn't fun lining them up, and there's not much you can really do to line them up apart from stick them on and fiddle with them. But doing this, I did kind of knock off the ends here and there, and it took me a very an embarrassingly long time to get all four wheels lined up. And looking back, they didn't turn out the greatest. It is unfortunately just a case of poking them around and yeah. And what I would suggest is do one wheel, leave a set, and then do another wheel, or do the wheels when they aren't on the car. Which I probably should have done. I should have taken them off. Just because you'll find you'll do one wheel, you'll turn it over to do the other one, and your hands are touching the other wheel and pulling it off and moving it about. I don't know from experience, I promise. I do. Anyway, so now we're going to move on to building the interior. Like I said in the previous videos, the fit of this kit is excellent. It all goes together really, really well. The paint kind of may cause issues in some places. So I say it goes together really, really well. I mean, it fit really well before paint. After paint, we did have some issues. So we're putting in the bulkhead here, and it didn't want to sit right, even though it sat lovely before paint. So yeah, we ended up getting our knife and just kind of trimming off the paint and a little bit of the actual plastic, just so it'll go in and it's not a tight fit, and then we can kind of fill the gap rather, with some super glue. So there we go, after a lot of chipping and chopping and fiddling and messing about, we did manage to get that to fit. So we're just going to put a big glob of the thicker super glue in there, just to kind of fill the gap and make sure it stays put, and then give it a push in just to make sure it is fully home. And then we're going to start putting the interior together. That's one thing this kit did do quite well, I think, and that's with kind of locating points and things like that. There's not much ambiguity in there. It's pretty straightforward and easy to understand. And as far as the interior and the chassis went, I think it was very well engineered and easy to put together. The engine, maybe not so much, and the body, again, maybe not so much. But yeah, it was just a very, very, like, the interior and the chassis they fit really well, and the engine and the body just kind of maybe needs a little work, or I don't know, maybe sand it, no, maybe mask it, no, see, it's, I know, just be careful. That's all I'm trying to say. I guess what I'm trying to say is the interior and the chassis went together really well. The engine, not so much. Which I've said about 6 times now while I'm just putting the interior of this together. So yeah, interior goes together really, really simple. You've got the bulkhead, the seats, the door cards, and the dashboard. One side fit quite well, the other side was a little loose, but that is just because of the way the interior tub went into the body. So just make sure you pop some glue on there, just to make sure it doesn't flop about. Okay, and then once we've done that, we're just going to leave the glue to set, have a brief little tidy, and a lunch break. And it was on this lunch break that I realised that I hadn't built the seatbelt. So the seatbelt comes with a kit. You get a piece of sticky back material and some photoetch parts. It's kind of cool that it comes with a kit. You don't have to buy aftermarket, but it's not the greatest of seatbelts. The sticky back material is kind of annoying, especially when putting these photoetch parts on, because they just stick in place and you've got to pull them and it kind of deforms the material slightly when you're pulling them. And yeah, I mean, while it's nice that it's sticky and it'll stick straight to the seat and whatnot, and you don't have to mess about with any extra glues or anything, yeah, I think gluing it myself wouldn't have been too much of an issue, and it would have probably been a little bit less hassle than this. But all in all, quite happy with them. Could be worse. There we go, now we've done the top ones, and then we're just going to do the side ones. And because of that sticky back on the material, it's easy to put onto the actual seat. And the sticky, it is sticky, just like the window masks. It really wants to stay in place, so once you've stuck it on, it's there. It ain't going anywhere, so you don't need any extra glue or anything. Yeah, and the seats, again, they fit in really, really easy. There's a locating point on each side and they just push in. I think they're exactly the same shape, so it doesn't really matter what side they go on. I would just say put the one with the seat belt in front of the steering wheel. Something I didn't realise about this until I was watching a video, is that it's right-hand drive, but the gear selector is on the right still, just so it's the, I guess it's because the American drivers, they didn't have to learn to shift with their left, which is really cool. But yeah, anyway, we're gonna move on now to the polishing, and we're using micro mesh, and we're using 6,000, 8,000, and 12,000. And yes, we have gone back in time here because I did polish before doing the rest of this. Just because, you know, I'd painted and I really, really wanted to polish the 2K. As you can see, we had some dust spots and some various bits and bobs, some orange peely areas. So what we've done is I've got some warm water here, and I've put a little bit of soap in there just for a bit of lubrication, shall we say. I know the water's lubrication, but I don't know, it's something I seen once and I thought, you know what, I'll give it a go. But anyway, that's why it looks like it does. It's a bit soapy. So yeah, we're going to come in first with the 6000. We're going to use this to get rid of the majority of the dust spots. And then we're going to work our way up through the grades. I don't think you want to see me sand in for ages and ages. So this is just a skip to the end where I'm just wiping off any kind of the leftover water. And you can see we got those dust spots out, which are on the top there. It's still a bit wet, so I do apologise for that. But our main problem were those dust spots, and we managed to get them out. Okay, and once we'd got that done, we were moving on to the UMP polishing system. So first up, we're using the polishing compound, and with this, this is step one of the three steps. So I'm using a microfiber cloth, which came with the polishing system, and I've just slightly dipped my finger in some water just to get that a little bit wet, and then I've got a bit of that polishing compound, and I'm just working it into the paint now. You do want to be a little bit careful because you can burn through still with the polishing compound, because at the end of the day it is an abrasive. But yeah, just be careful on kind of raised areas and stuff, and we just want to rub this in. Sometimes you don't actually have to go step one, step two, step three, depending on how your finish is. Sometimes you don't even have to micro mesh if your finish is good enough, but my finish is rarely good enough. So yeah, we're just gonna rub this in all over the body, just being careful of any kind of raised areas. We still want to go over these areas, but you just don't want to push too hard or spend too much time on them. And then if you give it a quick little buff, we're gonna move through to the wax next. Now the wax, I'm using straight out of the pot, and what we're gonna do is we're gonna put it on, we're gonna rub it in. We're going to use a different part of the cloth. And then what we're going to do is, once we've gone over the whole body and we've waxed everything up, we're going to leave the body aside before buffing it. We're going to leave it haze up, because that's kind of what you want to do with wax. You want to leave it haze, and then we can come back then once it's hazed, and we'll use a different microfiber just to get all the wax off. So there we go, we're coming in with a different microfiber now. This is a Chemical Guys one, which I bought for actually doing my bike. But that hasn't been used much, so it hasn't been washed much, so it's just sitting in the garage at the moment. So I've been using this on my models. But yeah, we just want to go over everything and rub off all that hazed up wax. And you should be left with a nice, nice shiny finish. You may end up with some residue in panel lines and stuff like that, and you can use an old toothbrush to get in and get that residue out. What I sometimes like to do is use a toothpick. But yeah, anyway, you end up with a nice shiny finish like this. There you can see the reflection of my ring light. Yeah, I was super happy with the finish on this. To be honest, I was chuffed with how it came out. Even though the colour is wrong and it looks a little washed out, the clear coat came out quite well. And considering it was my second ever time using the 2K, I absolutely love it. So now on to, we're pretty much coming very close to the end now, and we're just trying to fit the body on, and this wasn't fun. But what I found is if you put your finger on the middle as a brace, and then your thumb and your middle finger on the outside, you can kind of bend the body slightly. You want to bend the front end and just kind of slightly push it over this, the lip on the bottom of the car, because it's not a great fit. And then you want to just push it fully home. There are two locating points further up towards the back of that front shell, which is supposed to slot into. But yeah, like I said, the fit isn't great on the body, so there was quite a bit of finagling and manhandling. And then afterwards, when we got everything together, I did end up waxing again because it was just covered in fingerprints. And then the rear shell, this was the worst. There's two little locating points on the bottom of that blue kind of brace which form a hinge, so the back can open and close. But what I found is the back just doesn't close. I don't know if it was just because of the fitment. It's definitely user error. It's 100% me. I've kind of not paid as much attention at one point earlier on while putting the engine together, and it's caused a slight issue which has just been exacerbated by various other bits fitting on top, I suppose. I found that is kind of not, while I was doing it, I didn't find an easy way to do this rather than just put it on as far as it can go and just kind of manhandle it into place. Later on I did find if you put the front on first then slide the back into the hinges, it does fit a lot better. But at this point I was getting quite annoyed with it, as it just wasn't going well. But we glossed past that, and we started putting the windows on. Now I'm using some tacky glue from Hobbycraft. You can use PVA or anything, and I'm just filling the kind of areas. The glass goes on from the outside on here, so it could be the last kind of thing you do, which is great because you don't end up getting fingerprints and everything on it. Sometimes that can be an issue, I've heard, but I think this is the first kit I've done where the glass goes on from the outside, and it wasn't a problem for me, thankfully. It's just nice to just pop it on. But I'm using some cotton buds just to push it into place, just so I don't get loads of fingerprints over them. But yeah, fit was really well, just using that to wipe away any excess. The good thing with the PVA is it dries clear and you don't really have any issues of fogging up the glass. And then we've done the same on the back and the same on the sides. Again, all goes in from the outside. Fits really, really well as well, so I didn't have any issues with that. This one, it was kind of unavoidable getting fingerprints on, which is what another reason we ended up waxing the whole thing again afterwards. We're almost at the end now. All that was left was just go around the outside and paint using the Molotow liquid chrome. We're painting the kind of clips and the door handles and the side markers. The reason I left this till the very end is this Molotow chrome takes a while to dry properly, and you can handle it, and if you're handling it, it's gonna stick on your thumbs and you're gonna leave fingerprints everywhere, and you can dull it as well by handling it afterwards. So we left this to the very end. And with that, we are done. So, without the fit issues, I did actually really enjoy this. It's my first Le Mans car, it's my first, like, good race car that I've done. So yeah, I'm really, really chuffed with how it turned out. May have gone a little bit too far with the exhausts, but I still like how they came out. You can see there's a little gap on the body. But yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. You'll be able to see more photos of the build and stuff over on my Instagram. But thank you for watching. Don't forget to like, comment and subscribe. Have a great day and stay safe.